Hi, everyone. Thank you very much for joining me today. As Bill said, I'm going to be going through some tips and pointers for designing industrial Ethernet systems, and with some focus on Industry 4.0. So let's start off here. What is Ethernet? Kind of sounds like a dumb question. And if that's what you're thinking, that's good, because Ethernet is so well understood and so well known that it makes it a great choice in today's connected applications. In your office, everything around you is connected to the internet, and generally speaking, that's going to be through Ethernet. Within industrial applications, the amount of process and control information and data that's going to be delivered and collected is increasing exponentially. So the demands on the existing communications methods are becoming much greater day over day. So Ethernet's data rate or speed is actually much higher than a lot of the traditional field bus systems. And so it's becoming the most commonly used industrial communication protocol today, but it didn't used to be that way. So just quickly, let's go back in time a little bit and look at some of the traditional industrial field buses that are used and see what they were capable of. So there's a list here of various traditional industrial communications, and I want to draw your attention to the center and the right-hand column. If you take a look at them, many of them were able to drive quite long distances. For example, if you look at Modbus, you can see that it's able to drive as far as 1.2 kilometers. That's in the center column. If you look in the right column, it's only able to drive up to 50 meters. And of course, the reason for that is the data rate at which Modbus is being driven. Data rate and cable reach for these kinds of field buses are inversely proportional. So with this increase in data and speed being needed in industrial applications, these field buses don't necessarily meet all of the needs any longer. So why didn't we just use Ethernet from the beginning? Conventional Ethernet, as you can see here, it's interoperable. It can drive up to 100 meters. And also the data rate goes up to either 10 megabits a second, 100 megabits a second, or even higher, of course. So industrial Ethernet has much greater requirements. It needs all of those three, but in addition, it needs to be able to survive the very harsh environments of industrial applications. It needs to be pretty accurate as well. In traditional Ethernet, inaccuracy is a big inconvenience, but it's not catastrophic, and it can be in industrial Ethernet. And probably most important of all, the system must be deterministic. And traditional Ethernet was not deterministic, and with the advances in today's technologies, it has become that way. So I'm going to cover those three pieces in the course of this talk, but I'm going to start with latency, and this is going to address the determinism that we were just talking about. Why should you care about latency and determinism? What is it? So latency is actually going to impact the amount of time it takes for your system to produce a unit or have an output at the other end. And so in terms that really matter, the better the latency, the lower the cost per unit of production. Let's define a couple of things. So there's system latency and there's PHY latency. So we're going to start with PHY latency. What you can see here is a representation of the transmission process for Ethernet PHYs. And device or PHY latency refers to the amount of time it takes for that information to be processed by the device. What is determinism? So if you look at the picture here, you can see a timeline being represented. And determinism is the variance in the latency. And what I mean by that is this. If you look at the the length of latency here, you can see that it's 390 nanoseconds, which is a very short amount of time. But of course, every single time the signal goes through the system, it won't necessarily be exactly 390 nanoseconds. In this example, it could be as much as 30 nanoseconds less, or as much as 30 nanoseconds more. And that variance is known as the device's determinism. So within the system, you have a phi, and it is contributing to its latency to the overall system. And of course, the amount of that latency that has to be designed for depends upon both the nominal value of the latency and how deterministic that particular phi is. That's also true of everything else in the system. So you have to take into account latency of all the different components. Of course, the cabling isn't ideal, but contributes to latency as well. So if you can minimize latency and improve determinism as much as possible, it will improve your throughput, and therefore it's going to minimize your cost per unit getting through the system. Earlier I mentioned the device needs to be very robust to be able to survive in an industrial system. So let's talk about that a little bit more. So from the overall system perspective, you need to be able to pass various compliance and conformance testing to be able to release the product that you're making. Now, it's much easier to do that if you are using devices that have already gone through compliance and conformance testing, which is usually true for Ethernet PHYS. Here's an example of some of the testing that Ethernet PHYS have to go through, and this is actually for EMI. This is a CISPR 11 test, which talks about how bad the emissions or good the emissions of the particular PHY are. So the PHY can't emit too many emissions, obviously. And if you look at the graph here, you can see two masks. The top one is in blue, and it's a little higher up the y-axis. And the middle one is in red, and that's slightly lower on the y-axis. And the idea behind it is that the device or system being tested must not exceed either of those masks. And of course, if it doesn't exceed the lower mask, which is true in this case, it's even better because the emissions are smaller. And this is known as class B conformance and compliance. And if the device is class B, it's even less likely to impact surrounding devices. So that's how the device affects the surroundings. How about how the surroundings affects the device? Again, it's an industrial environment. There's probably quite a bit of noise, as in electromagnetic noise, around the system. And so you want to make sure that the PHY itself does not pick up on that noise and have it affect the integrity of the signal that you're trying to transmit and receive. So what is looked for is that there's minimal impact on device performance. And in this case, class A is the best. Effectively, it doesn't make any difference to how the device is performing. And you can see in the table here that there are different grades all the way down to class D, where the device isn't just affected, but it's damaged by an ESD event or an EFT event or some other situation in the system. So we've talked about signal integrity. The other thing that you can do, in addition to making sure you choose components that have very low latency and very very close determinism, make sure you choose devices that have already gone through the conformance testing so that your job becomes simpler in the end. Of course, the other major thing that you can have impact on yourself is to make sure you use really good design techniques. And again, the point behind that is to make sure that your signal integrity stays very good. The reason for that is that you already have loss over the length of a cable. You want to make sure that that loss isn't too great. So if you, for example, if you are driving a differential signal into that cable and it already has some common mode offset on there, you are in a situation now where one side of the signal might look saturated, the other side might look attenuated. And because of that, you're effectively reducing the dynamic range that's available to you to send the signal. And naturally, signals attenuate over distance, and so it won't be able to go as far. So signal integrity is really important when designing systems that involve any kind of communications. So high level, how do you design your board? What you want to do is you want to put all of your high frequency signals, anything that's a little bit more active, in the center of the board. And the reason for that is that it's much easier then to correctly route those differential signals. And in addition, you can keep your analog signals and your digital signals further apart. You can also minimize the length of those traces that do have digital signals on them so that you don't have any crosstalk or interaction between the devices. It also gives you the ability to really adjust the placement of your analog blocks so that they don't have any impact on the digital components. So just quick summary. To maximize your throughput, you want to use an entire system that's designed to minimize latency and also make sure that the latency doesn't vary too much. You want a really deterministic system, because the shorter the amount of time that you have per cycle, the more cycles you can get into a larger amount of time. And of course, that means more throughput and more profitability. To make it easier to design your systems, it's often easy just to go ahead and use devices that are part of your system that have already gone through all of the testing, compliance and conformance testing. Oftentimes, you will find that these devices, like Ethernet PHYS, have evaluation modules, EVMs, available, and those EVMs have often gone through these kinds of conformance testing already. And so if that's the case, what you can do is you can just take that schematic and that layout and reuse it in your system. And you can be quite confident that at that point, the PHY won't contribute to any degradation of the EMI, ESD, EFT type of performance. And then, of course, if you design your system well, it's going to be able to drive cables further, it's going to last longer, and so you will have lower ongoing maintenance costs because it will be robust in design as well as intrinsically. So that's industrial Ethernet today. It's conventional Ethernet. What's coming? Well, what's coming is pretty exciting, and it's because there is just so much more data coming through the network. With big data, you have sensors collecting information and sending it back to PLCs, and even perhaps back to the desk of the person who's driving the entire system. Everything needs to be connected, as you'd expect, and so today, as we said before, the Ethernet systems are interoperable. We can reach about 100 meters. The data rate is up to about a gig. It does go higher than that in some cases. We're robust, we talked about that. We're accurate, we're deterministic. So what's the problem? Well, it's not so much a problem as a difference. If you take a look at those field buses we looked at earlier in the presentation, you can see that this 100 meters that's available from industrial Ethernet today, and some devices do go further, but not to the extent we're seeing here in the field buses. Field buses that are traditional do tend to go up to much longer distances. They just can't do that and support the higher speeds at the same time. They can go at some of the higher speeds, 10 megabits per second there for a CC link, for example, but then they're limited to the same distance that 10 meg Ethernet travels today. So to be able to do better there, we want to actually increase the cable length that Ethernet is capable of driving. What if we could do 1,000 meters or a kilometer or potentially more and still maintain that data rate of 10 megabits per second? Suddenly you have the best of both worlds. You get the long reach and the higher rate to be able to control things faster, more precisely, and collect more information. This is how it's going to happen. There's a new protocol that was just released toward the end of last year. The standard is IEEE 802.3CG. It's also known as single pair Ethernet or 10 base T1L, and the L stands for long distance. These devices, or this protocol, is able to support what I just described, 10 megabits per second and a kilometer in reach. Now, the other really interesting thing about this new single pair Ethernet technology is it's also specified for 100 meg, and then in addition, 1,000, which is a gigabyte. Getting tongue-tied, sorry. So let's look at the difference between those. There's another key difference between standard or conventional Ethernet and single twisted pair Ethernet. It's hidden in the name, or maybe not so much hidden. Single pair Ethernet only needs one single twisted pair to transmit data and also power if you like. Standard Ethernet, if it's 10/100, it only needs two twisted pairs. Nonetheless, you're already at double the amount of wiring cabling needed. And for gig transportation, it actually requires four twisted pairs. Additionally, standard Ethernet, while it's very solid, it's deterministic, it's reliable, robust, withstands harsh environments, it's full duplex, it only goes up to 100 meters. So it's been an absolutely wonderful intersection between existing field buses that we talked about earlier and what's coming down the pike, which is single twisted pair. You do see in single pair Ethernet in the early days, there is still some of that relationship, that inverse relationship between distance and data rate. However, the data rate starts so much greater that it's still a significant benefit to the system in which it's used. So what I'm saying there is that at 1 kilometer, you're already at 10 megabits per second. And at 100 meg, you're able to do 50 meters, which is significantly greater than the previous field buses that we discussed earlier. And the specifications that I've discussed so far in single twisted pair Ethernet are all full duplex. And of course, there are more being developed and coming down the pike. So what I've described today is using devices that are already low latency and deterministic in your system to maximize your throughput and your profit. Make sure you use devices that can withstand harsh industrial environments to minimize your maintenance costs and also make your design and compliance and conformance testing easier. And then make sure you maintain that signal integrity to maximize your cable length reach by using strong design practices.